the Son, with the Holy Spirit. May the Father of mercies, the God of all consolation, be with all of you. My brothers and sisters, we have come together to renew our trust in Christ, who by dying on the cross has freed us from eternal death, and by rising has opened for us the gates of heaven. Let us pray for our brother, that he may share in Christ's victory. Let us pray for ourselves, that the Lord may grant us the gift of his loving consolation. Brother and I would have preferred to start learning how to fish by going out and catching a few, omitting entirely anything difficult or technical in the way of preparation that would take away from the fun. But it wasn't by way of fun that we were introduced to our Father's art. If our Father had had his say, nobody who did not know how to fish would be allowed to disgrace a fish by catching it. I think Uncle Andy was successful in teaching his children how to fish. I don't know how much the Marine in him came out in that, in this description of learning to fish from a river runs through it, a story in which the boundaries between religion and fishing were very blurred. There was a lot of wisdom there, but Uncle Andy taught lessons in life, certainly with a Marine spirit. There's at least two or three of my brothers who picked up the bug as well, from Uncle Andy, I suspect, as well as their own grandfather on my dad's side. But I don't fish that often. But I think I understand part of the allure of fishing, even the spirituality of it. The waters, dark, deep places. There's an art to knowing how to penetrate into the unknowable and perhaps entice a fish to strike that hook or that bait, and then to be able to bring it in, land it in the boat or on the shore. The landing of a fish or a net full of shrimp, crab gnawing at the chicken neck, up to the net. It's a good metaphor for the sheer grace of life, the bounty of life. And certainly, Uncle Andy knew how to harvest the bounty of the sea. He saw water around here. And, gave me a lifelong, if not love of fishing, at least a lifelong love of seafood. It's in the context of a bountiful catch of fish that the disciples of Jesus recognize he's alive, resurrected. And that makes sense. They're open to seeing the abundance of God's grace, the impossible that we've seen of this one alive and in God, in part because they've drawn from the water such an abundance of fish. The netting of so many fish helps them realize there's a grace here. Of course, the grace is even bigger when they recognize the one standing on the shore. With faith in the resurrection, Jesus' disciples can live out a fundamental stance of trust that God brings forth life and enables life to the full, even out of tragedy, even beyond our existence on this earth. Uncle Andy certainly religious in his faith. But I think he lived a life of faith. That faith included faith in his country, despite all his conspiracy theories. I don't think he betrayed being American or any other place in the world. He served his country in the Marines for 30 years, in some of the times the greatest danger to our democracy that we've ever experienced. He saw war at its harshest and most horrific, and he was willing to make the ultimate sacrifice that was possible for our country. He also had faith in Aunt Charlotte. We partnered together for 70 years. Wonderful. Amazing. Just a month ago or so, I asked him, what was the secret of 70 years? And he said, pick out the right one at the start. He couldn't have picked out a more religious spouse than Aunt Charlotte. And perhaps it was one of the contrasts there was between them. But he supported her in these many years. And Aunt Charlotte, you did connect him to the church, even if it was somewhat kicking and screaming, perhaps on his part. And even if he was more likely to spend time at the altar of creation around him than he was in the church. Together, as evidence of the life that God brings forth, they brought forth a family, a beautiful family, 7 children, that in turn has become all the more spreading outward in two more generations now of family. And he loved you. I know he was a disciplinarian with a Marine subtlety, but you can see, you know, your own closeness is evidence of the parents, both parents, attentiveness and love and nurturing and discipline that brought y'all together. I can see it as tenderness in the way he would hold a grandchild. Cycle of seasons. The sheer gift of grapefruits and pears that made it through the freezes, or the grapes and the okra that produced bumper crops. This connection to the cycles of seasons was a deep part of the spirituality of faith. And then, of course, there was the cycle of the tides. The waters and the creeks, the rivers and the bays, the Beaufort area and the Ace Basin. Deep part of the spirituality and faith, a good metaphor for the depths of life and its mystery, the presence of God. He didn't do it perfectly, had his faults and shortcomings. But as we lay him to rest, we give thanks to God for Andy Anderson. All the ways he's shown us that deep down there is an abundance from which we can draw strength, joy, and delight. Which we can live in hope that God is continually drawing forth a new life for us. For that life eternal, we trust Him today. We now bless the ground. Christ, by your own 3 days in the tomb, you hallowed the graves of all who believe in you. So made the grave a sign of hope that promises resurrection, even as it claims our mortal bodies. Grant that our brother may sleep here in peace until you awaken him to glory. For you are the resurrection and the life. And he will see you face to face. In your light, he will see light. Know the splendor of God, for you live and reign forever and ever. Separate ways to take leave of our brother. May our farewell express our affection for him. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet him again. The love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself. Into your hands, Father of mercy, we commend our brother Andy, in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon him in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant. And help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our brother forever. We ask this in Christ our Lord. Eternal rest grant unto them, O Lord, and that perpetual life will shine upon them. And he rest in peace. May his soul, the soul of all faithful departed, the mercy of God, rest in peace. The Lord be with you. Bow your heads for the blessing. For the peace of God, which is beyond all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us go. Before I turn things over to Ernie, we've been asked to invite everyone to come back to St. Peter's, the church, to the hall there, to have a luncheon together and do our company job. Share with you is, if I mention places like Operation Desert Storm, Operation Kosovo, Helmand Province, Bagram, Syria, name places like Syria and Damascus, these Marines know all too well about Helmand. They all know too well about Bagram. They all knew too well about Syria. Those places we all would recognize, but if I told you Operation Pestilence, if I told you Operation Batman, take Gloucester. If I told you Operation Iceberg, Okinawa. If I named places like Peleliu, Solomon Islands, Incheon, Joseon, you know where they are. These Marines know where they are. Those are the battles that fought and forged this nation. Dad was part of that, that forged this nation. He was part of what they call the old Greek. Hoorah!
Hoorah!
Growing up in Alabama, taught Dad how to hunt, how to fish, how to farm. He told me a story that his mother gave him. We'd give him 522 longs. And they'd tell him, go out and get supper. Get five shells. So if he went out and he got three rabbits or three squirrels, he better come back with two other shells. Because if he didn't, he'd get one less shell. And then he may go hungry. So tell me that didn't build marksmanship, right? So take a person like that and sign him up in the United States Marine Corps, put an M1 in his hand and all the ammunition he wants, and a 600-yard target, you got a deadly force. You got a deadly force. When I was 16 years old, I had a motorcycle, as we all know. And I chopped that motorcycle up, put headers on it, put velocity stacks, you know, made it what it is, and parked that motorcycle in the front yard. I was coming home for lunch to see Mom. And my dad's out in the front yard pouring with the water hose and squirt water up the carburetor up the velocity stacks. And I look at Mom and said, Mom, look at this. And I said, I'm going out there to whoop his ass. And I'm walking out the door, and she grabs me. She says, and Mom, thank you for saving my life. I wouldn't be here today if you hadn't stopped me from going out that front door. So, but what she told me, she said that the wars changed. The battles we saw changed. And she mentioned the Korean War. She said, what's Korea? But as I got older, I started reading more about the wars, about World War II, about the battles that he just fought. It gave me some insight into who he was as a person. I mean, when you look at the wars that he fought in, some hand-to-hand combat, pistols, rifles, bayonets, grenades, flamethrowers, rocket launchers, Tommy guns, and then he had to battle monsoons, searing heat, humidity, frozen chosen, minus 32 degrees in battles and an enemy all around him. So you take all that and you put it into a mold and you squeeze it and you shape it and you form it. What do you get? You get our dad. You get a Marine. So as these Skull and Guards stand here today, they stand on shoulders of my father. They taught him how to fight. They taught him how to win wars.
He was a hell of a Marine. He's an American hero. Hoorah!
Hoorah! Hoorah!
The name Anderson. To me, it's synonymous with courage. Courage to face your fears, to know your weaknesses, to turn them into your strengths. Integrity. Be a man of honor, a man of conviction. Stay true to yourself. A man of commitment. Don't quit. Never quit. Keep on pushing. Keep on fighting. A man of hard work. Nothing worth having isn't worth working for, you say. And pride, almost to a gentleman. Would never take a handout from anybody. Never wanted a handout from anybody. That's who he was. So, this is the foundation that he left us, and those characteristics are exemplified in his children, and their children, and their children. And that's what he leaves us as a legacy in his name. I remember at Dad's 90th birthday, Colonel Gabrowski, Chief of Staff of Paris Island, sitting up here, and he was looking around over the crowd. And he said, I may not be an Anderson, and I may not be part of the Anderson extended family. And he looked at Dad and he said, but I'm part of his family. So that's the foundation Dad left with us. I could just say, Semper Fi, Dad. Hoorah!
Hoorah! Hoorah.